The fourth session before the closing, and that is 9/11 and war crimes, a panel discussion and recommendation. And for this next session, the chairman will be Professor Gurdial Singh Nijar. He's from the Faculty of Law, University of Malaya, Malaysia. And I would also like to invite all the panelists from the previous sessions up on stage to join Professor Gurdial. And that would be Ms. Cynthia McKinney, Mr. James Corbett, Mr. Richard Gage, Professor Michelle Chosudovsky, Professor Graham McQueen, Professor Niloufar Bhagwat, Professor Dr. Hans Kirkley, already there, and also Mr. Chisa and Dr. Chandra Muzaffar. Yes.
Thank you very much, and welcome to the final component of the forum. We have listened, I think, with great fascination to the thought-provoking presentations since this morning by the very distinguished experts, speakers, on this rather critical topic. What it has resulted in, I think, in our minds, the converted and those who came here to inquire as to the content of and direction of the incident, the 9/11 historic incident, is that there are a large number of unresolved questions, and therefore we have to decide what next. How do we resolve these questions, these issues? And the way in which we are going to proceed with this final session is that each of the speakers, starting, I suppose, from my left, will be given 2-3 minutes to address specifically this question. And perhaps 5 important facets need to be addressed. The first is, of course, what is to be done? And what are the characteristics of whatever you want to do? How do we follow up on this? Because there is this wealth of information. There is this search for truth, the quest for justice that has to be accomplished for all of the reasons that these speakers have so eloquently presented. So what is to be done? What are the characteristics of this? Should it be international? Should it be fact-finding? Should it be an inquiry? If it is the inquiry, what sort of inquiry? Then how is it to be done? The general criteria, what are the values that such a fact-finding should embrace? What is the process? Should it be open? Should it be transparent? Should it be evidence-based? How do we establish its credibility? And also the form and manner in which we are going to proceed with whatever we intend to set up to try to search for this truth. Fourthly, we'll have to come up with specific terms of reference. What precisely will be the scope of this, whatever we decide to finally set up? And finally, the fifth point is, what is this, whatever we decide, a body, an inquiry commission, and so on, what will it deliver? So we open the floor for these, try to address these questions, because this will then form the basis upon which we will then move forward. in this process. Yes, Madam Nilofo.
We had an informal brainstorming session in last evening because it was unanimously felt that it was not enough for us to discuss, but it was necessary to go forward after this conference. And a suggestion was put forward to which we all broadly agreed that it is necessary for an organization like the Perdana or similar organizations to sponsor an international commission on 9/11. But this would not be a tribunal, but a commission of experts and eminent persons, because one of the criticisms which was made against the so-called official commission on 9/11 of the United States government was that it had no experts. And during the discussion, you have seen what was the nature. A little bit of insight has been given into the fact that this was no commission at all, and it was set up to fail. Secondly, I feel that it is time that, of course, this is immediate. The first is immediate and priority. But the second is also important, which we could consider and discuss and then formalize at some late stage. What we need desperately is a perspective for the development, overall development and welfare of humanity for the 21st century. And we just had a very thought-provoking session, and that is what has inspired me to state that we have eminent individuals who have already started the process of discussing and thinking that the world has reached a crisis. That conclusion is unavoidable. The crisis is not only in one area. It is a crisis which embraces practically every aspect of human endeavor. And therefore, it's time that we have a body which seriously sets about considering as to what are our perspectives on development, on finance, on the currency, on war, as a kind of a manifesto for humanity, to draw up a manifesto, a broad manifesto for humanity. Because with the capitulation of the alternative political system broadly headed by the USSR and other countries, politically we are facing a vacuum. Humanity is facing a vacuum. We cannot allow this vacuum to continue, because this vacuum is being actually occupied by anti-humanity forces. Therefore, this is also a priority. The third is an issue also which we discussed and we left incomplete, is the strange phenomena of the Al-Qaeda and similar such organizations, which have been floated with the collaboration of countries and governments which call themselves Islamic, and which are committing some of the most criminal and horrendous acts, jeopardizing the lives and future of whole societies. And presently we are seeing what has happened in Syria, what has happened in Libya, and what has happened in Afghanistan, what has happened in so many countries. and of course the ambassador who was chairing our session, he said that as far as the OIC is concerned, it is only OIC, and that we cannot expect any kind of assistance from them, because they, some of these governments have been a part of this. But these kind of forces which have been unleashed and just left to attack, prey on countries, which are a mercenary force, it has to be investigated as much as 9/11 needs to be investigated. 9/11 is priority. But at some stage, if some governments can apply their mind to an investigative commission on this issue, it would help humanity. Thank you.
Well, I came here to hear ideas, and I'm still listening. I don't have a simple solution to what we should do next. I'm going to simply suggest one or two little ideas, throw them into the pot, so to speak. I like the idea that we came up with last evening about a new commission of inquiry. In terms of getting real experts to be part of that, I don't see a problem. The world is full of experts, physicists, engineers, you know, social scientists, no problem. We already know lots of good people. The tricky part comes when you say, ah, yes, but this has to be a credible commission. We all understand that it has to be credible, but the concept of credibility is actually quite complex. Someone who is credible to you may be lacking in credibility to me. There's no such thing as a person who is credible to everyone. So, although I would love to have a commission of inquiry which is credible for the Canadian Parliament, for example, given that I'm from Canada, I wonder if that's not a waste of time right now. I wonder if there's no possibility of that. Is it possible for us to have a commission that is credible with the New York Times? I rather doubt it. This has to do with the nature of hegemony and so on. Perhaps we should be clear about who it is we want to be credible to, and then go from there. If, for example, we said, how about a commission of inquiry which is credible to the non-aligned movement, or again, to the global south, or to Asia, whatever, we could still end up with a group of people that we're trying to talk to who represent billions of people. Billions of people who matter. And if we did decide, this is a brainstorm kind of idea I'm giving here. If we decided that was going to be our target group, the first thing we would have to do is include them in the planning. We don't pick our experts and then just try to persuade them. We say, tell us who your experts are, people who you trust, and we will include them in this commission. And that's all I'm going to suggest for now. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm also inclined towards this idea of a commission of inquiry. An international commission of inquiry may be difficult to get people who would be acceptable to all shades of opinion within this very broad spectrum that we are looking at. But if we can get people who have some standing and credibility with perhaps a certain range of groups and individuals within that spectrum, it would be sufficient for a start. If we can get a commission of about 6 or 7 persons and define their terms of reference very clearly, because I think what is really critical would be the terms of reference. what would the commission look at? I would suggest off the cuff that the commission should look at the official report first, produced by the US government. And then we could look at this huge volume of literature that has been generated by the 9/11 truth movement, or movements, since there are different movements that are involved. You can look at that literature and juxtapose that literature with the official version. And if one has a good secretariat, one should be able to analyze the major findings from both these sources in a very short while, actually, since all the material is there. And then I suppose the commission, like all commissions, would come out with their findings, and those findings could be the basis for legal action. In other words, commission first, findings emanating from the commission, and legal action, which would again depend upon the findings. Yesterday we talked about the length of time and so on. If we looked at it as a process that builds upon previous efforts, I do not think we need to work within the range of 2 years or 3 years. I see no reason why, if we can set up a commission very quickly, meaning by which the panel, if that can be done, this sort of work within 6 months, I think one should be able to come up with the findings, since all the material is already there. It's not as if one is going on a fact-finding mission, which is different. And some commissions of inquiry do that, but here we are thinking of a different sort of commission of inquiry, which would build upon work that has already been done. So one can announce one's findings, and then those findings could be the basis for action within domestic law, as far as the United States is concerned, and that would be a different exercise from, say, the sort of findings which one would want to use as a basis for action at other levels in the international arena. It's a little limited, but nonetheless, I think things can be done at the international arena. Thank you very much.
Well, I share very much the consideration of Graham McQueen about the question of the commission. Certainly, I agree for the on the idea of a commission of experts and personalities, but with some of detail of description. The first, I should say, that we need experts and personalities because we need names able to give a mainstream credibility. The question, how we can be credible for the New York Times? You will not resolve the problem because never the New York Times will accept this work, even the work, independently by the content. And this will be the same thing for all the mainstream media dominating the West. They are not able and not in condition to be objective because they are owned by the organizers of 9/11. This is my idea. And that means, well, not in Italy, neither in Italy nor in Germany nor in the United States, you will not find newspaper or TV channel independent to a level to give credibility to our work. No, this is impossible. You can gain some credibility if you gather a certain number of very important, influential, wise people in all the sector of culture who join this company. That means I propose that preliminarily we should decide which kind of people will create this commission. This morning I am working on 9/11 already from the beginning. Today I heard, this morning especially, very important conclusion. I consider the things you have heard this morning a conclusion. The work which has been done is a huge work, We can't begin from the very beginning. I agree with you that we have to take into account the 9/11 Commission report. But after the 9/11 Commission report, the movement in the world has made a huge amount of researches, data, which has been accumulated. We have not to come back to the beginning. This work is very precious. That means we need, from the very beginning, a group of people able to collect people, groups, who already worked, and decide, because we have no other matter, decide who they are, our first point of reference. We are beginning from there. The method is wonderful. I mean, architect and engineer for truth this morning showed a very high level of scientific procedure. There is the 9/11 consensus panel, there is pilot for truth, and other existing groups. We should begin gather this first. Second, I believe that we need a permanent structure, because the movement is very large. We don't need a commission of authorities who will gather once in a year. It's not good. It will not work. We need a permanent structure, organizational structure, capable to receive information, because the movement is very large all over the world, and to give back the best information which is existing. That means we need a very powerful database controlled by a group of professionals able to diffuse and receive. And this is the beginning of the working. After that, certainly we will have to produce legal expertise and to find a place where we can go straight to the point to indicate. To this moment, we have some ideas about who are the culprits, but we have to define the procedure, the way to go straight to the result, to find those who are responsible, or to find the documents which will give us the possibility to find those who are responsible. That means, resuming, I believe we need a group of people who gather the most important expert together, and in the same time to create a database of name of very important international personalities in all field of culture and labor and so on. Third, create a database of documented researches already available, and a permanent structure capable to organize practically the continuity of this work. Thank you.
I also think that the best way to proceed under the circumstances may be to set up what I would call an independent international commission of inquiry. And independent is very important, because that commission, which has made a report in the United States, was not really independent. What is important is that such a commission of inquiry will include the experts from all the various technical fields, and they must be people with impeccable academic credentials. Otherwise, if it would be, it should not be so that the conclusions will be dismissed as political. What is, in my view, also important is that one is trying to make a synthesis of all the different efforts and investigations that have been undertaken so far at the local level, because there are groups that have investigated this in the United States, in Canada, in Australia, in Japan, in several European countries, but the problem is that there is no coordination and no synthesis. And the one more aspect I want to mention, in light of my experience now, it is more than 10 years with this so-called Lockerbie affair, namely that terrorist incident in the United Kingdom, the bombing of the Pan American jetliner in 1988. There was a trial, and there was a big public debate in the United Kingdom and in the United States. And what I was one of the observers, and I was the only one, by the way, who made a report for the United Nations. My four colleagues thought it was not wise, it was not prudent to go public with their opinion. So I did, and that's why I learned my lessons. And the interesting thing was, there was a total difference in terms of media coverage and critical, asking of critical questions between the United Kingdom and the United States. In the United States, you just had more or less uniform coverage according to the views of the government and the American intelligence establishment. In the United Kingdom, there was more critical coverage in the media, including the establishment media, and I think that somehow is the reason why in the UK, and particularly in Scotland, where it happened, a substantial majority of the population does not believe in the official explanation, and people are speaking out. So it's a totally different climate, and that's why I think it is so important that one is also focusing on working with the media. It's not sufficient to come up with a lucid and concise and convincing argument. One has always to do also this other part of work. So that's my observation.
We have been discussing the avenues which we wish to adopt both in this session, but also prior to this session. I think we have to understand that war propaganda and media propaganda, mainstream media propaganda, are complicit in the crimes of 9/11. And that means that if we want to disarm this inquisitorial system, which is far worse than the Spanish Inquisition or even the French Inquisition for that matter, we have to address the fabrications of, precisely of, the mainstream media. We're not seeking their support. We are confronting the mainstream media. Without the media, the global war on terrorism would fall flat. It would fall flat. It wouldn't have a leg to stand on. And consequently, the Commission of Inquiry must confront not only politicians and the financiers behind this project, because it, as Mr. Chiesa has pointed out, this is a project of the financial elites. But their legitimacy is based on a propaganda apparatus which is extremely sophisticated and extensive in networking all over the world. And consequently, we have to break that. And it's something which can be broken because it's very fragile. It's extremely, a lie is fragile, okay? Like the Spanish Inquisition is fragile. So what I'm suggesting is the following. Let us proceed with, as I think that's the consensus here, with a commission of inquiry, very selective, very focused. But let us build upon, or let us use this commission of inquiry to interface with other initiatives, to establish an extremely broad network of counter-propaganda. of counter-propaganda, that is absolutely essential. Because, and it is easier, as we have seen, to break the BBC than it is to break the Pentagon, okay? The BBC is lying. They can be taken to court because war propaganda is a lie, okay? I'm sorry, war propaganda is a crime. And when the BBC shows Indian flags in Tripoli celebrating the victory of the rebellion with fake images, they are, in fact, committing a war crime. They are complicit in war crimes. So that, essentially, I would suggest commission of inquiry. We have to think very carefully how we want to formulate the legal actions. Scientists who lie are also complicit in war crimes. I think that's clear in Richard Gage's presentation. People who lie in their professional fields, they are complicit in war crimes. Scientists who say that nuclear weapons are harmless to the surrounding civilian population are liars, and they are complicit in war crimes. So consequently, I say, let us proceed and think very carefully the commission of inquiry, but let us also see who we want to target as part of a legal mechanism. I suggest, let's start by going after the media. I'm not seeking the friendliness with the media or their support. Precisely, we are confronting the media. The media is not covering, won't cover objectively what is happening in this venue. But we have a very powerful networking, also with the internet, where we can go after the media and confront them, politely confront them on the lies which are tantamount to war crimes because they are denying and covering up crimes against humanity as well as conspiracies such as those of 9/11. Thank you.
The architects and engineers for 9/11 Truth have signed a petition calling upon Congress, the U.S. Congress, for a real investigation. We've taken a lot of heat for this. How can we, after all, obtain a real investigation from those who have either taken part in or had endorsed the original 9/11 Commission report? But the American people will not, as of yet, understand our lack of faith in our democratic institutions in the United States. So we need to take that path and exhaust those resources that our forefathers gave to us in the U.S. in order to be able to hold our elected representatives accountable. So to that end, the question, what kind of a technical investigation will we find acceptable is a good one. And we, of course, need an unimpeachable investigation, one that includes all of the evidence, not just that which the National Institute of Standards and Technology cherry-picked in their technical building reports. We expect the scientific method to be used relative to all of that evidence. That immunity is offered to bring forth witnesses and that testimony taken under oath. So these are the prescriptive measures that we'll find acceptable. And I hope that is a beginning to a real investigation.
Thank you very much. As the youngest member of this panel by several decades, I feel woefully unqualified to be speaking here today. But if there is any subject on which I am qualified to speak, it would be as a representative of the global alternative media movement, of which I am one small, but not insignificant, I hope, a member. And it occurs to me that very much in accord with what Professor McQueen and Professor Chasadovsky were saying. It is very important that we understand what type of inquiry or whatever comes out of this we want to set up and who our intended audience is. Because exactly as they've laid out here, I don't think there will be any possibility of setting up any kind of inquiry that would be acceptable to the New York Times or whatever other papers of record might currently exist in the media paradigm. But perhaps this is the most optimistic and empowering message that we've heard so far today. I think we can take an example, for example, a biblical allegory of David versus Goliath. Everyone in this room, not just the people on the podium, but everyone in this room is the David against the Goliath of the mainstream media. But in that story, we can overcome it, even with inferior resources. And I point as one tiny example of this, I see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, at least 5 cameras hungrily trained on us right now, recording every word that we're saying. But as far as I know, this video has not ever been in the history of this conference or tribunal or what happens in Kuala Lumpur made available to the public, and I don't know if it ever will be. But I myself have a little handheld camera, which probably in and of itself is 1/10 as expensive as any one of these cameras, which I'm going to take back with me to Japan. I'm going to post the video that I managed to capture of today's conference before my batteries ran out on my website or on my YouTube channel. And in a matter of hours, it is going to garner thousands of views and hopefully over the lifetime of the video, tens of thousands or perhaps even hundreds of thousands of views. So to put that into perspective, within a matter of hours, probably 100 times more people will have watched it than have actually attended this conference. Now, this is the power of the alternative global media landscape that we are in. And I posit that it might be something that a lot of people tend to leave out of the equation of the age in which we are living, that literally what you hold in your hand, what you hold in your hand might be the tool with which we delegitimize the system that has been oppressing us. Every single person in this room who has access to an iPhone slave device or whatever your medium of choice is, to tweet or Facebook or post or however so you connect to social media can help to spread the message of what we're talking about today and to help potentially unlock tens, hundreds, thousands, or even millions of minds. And I say this from the perspective of someone who spent September 11th, 2011, the 10th anniversary of 9/11, in my pajamas in my living room, making a video which has now been seen by 1.6 million people talking about the truth of 9/11. So I'm not saying this as just something to rally the crowd. I'm saying this quite literally. Every single one of us in the room has the power to change the world. And if we simply start to use that power and stop giving into the system, we can and we will make a difference. Thank you.
James is absolutely right, but I have to apologize to you because I'm really running low on fuel at about 36 hours with very little sleep. Would that video, James, be the 5-minute? If you have not seen James Corbett's 5-minute 911 truth video, please look it up tonight. Don't let 1 minute pass without you seeing that video because it captures the absurdity of the official story and he's so clever in the way that he does it. Now, you see, there's something I'd like to say to Richard because he's talking about signing a petition to Congress. I'd like to see Richard run for Congress. That's what we need. We need members of architects and engineers for 911 truth inside Congress. We need the members of the 911 truth organizations or movement around the country, around the United States. We need them running for public office. This is the whole point of how we're going to make change. And it's not that we petition those people, we become those people who are making decisions on our behalf. Maybe just go back to Congress. That'll The other thing that I would like to acknowledge is the fact that we have a community of people across the United States who have given up their professional lives because they've been so moved by what happened on September 11th. I don't know when the last time was Richard drew up an architectural plan. Okay, 4 years. And we have professors, we have young people, we have people who have just decided that they are going to become the leaders that the United States and that this movement needs, and that they are going to become the change that we're all looking for. There's one organization of young people that actually goes out and searches for those people who are complicit in the crimes of 9/11 and the crimes against the people of, well, really, the global community. And they confront them one-on-one. And I'm talking about We Are Change. And they record their confrontation with these people, and they ask the tough questions. They give a sense of courage to everyone else to go out and ask these questions, sort of like those questions that I was asking of Rumsfeld. I wouldn't dare try and suggest how this next phase would be structured, but the fact that we are here is significantly important. I have taken such a beating just for asking one simple question. I'm glad that Dr. Mahathir has decided that he has the courage and the willingness and the readiness to dedicate his reputation to this issue. Everyone in this room has been affected. There are some legal structures inside the United States that could be activated. And so we had a meeting, as is clear now, last night, and I mentioned some of those legal structures that would provide the force of the state to have, so that in an inquiry or after the inquiry in the legal stage, then these findings are presented with the force of subpoena power and penalty of perjury. This is the kind of thing that hasn't taken place. And we have so many people in the United States who are 911 truthers, the truthers. We have people who know viscerally that the government story isn't right, but they don't know what is right. And so this provides a tremendous opportunity for all of us to educate a community, I believe, that is ready to hear our message. They weren't ready in 2001 or 2002 or 2003, but I believe that we have literally hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of Americans who are ready to hear this message. And so what I would also just caution us to do is to make sure that we connect with that. There is an international 911 truth movement, but fundamentally we have business that needs to be taken care of inside the United States. And we have a vibrant 911 truth movement that's just looking for something to grab onto. Kuala Lumpur can provide the U.S. 911 truth movement something to grab onto, and hopefully We can change Washington, D.C. so that we can change the world. Thank you.
Thank you very much to the panel. And now perhaps we can open the floor to participants to provide some input. Let's not forget that a mother's love for her child's voice and posting it on YouTube created phenomena like Justin Bieber, for example, and a guy in our Asian context making some funny hand movements which were difficult to understand created the Gangnam viral. So there is an ability to be able to reach out beyond what we can sometimes expect. So perhaps the youth, the young people can make some contribution and suggest what are the kind of methods we can pursue in the next couple of minutes. So any speakers want to give their viewpoints? Oh yes, Tun. Another young person, Tun Mahade.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for giving me this opportunity. I've been listening to all the views, the reports, and the suggestions as to what we should do after this. I agree that we should have a commission. I have no problem with that. But I would like to draw attention to a power that is much greater than all the governments of Europe and America. And the power is the power of the people. They decide who should rule the country. Now, we have some experience, of course, of the way democracy works. When people are divided, or divided equally, a small group can actually determine who would win. Now, I had this experience during the course of my political career. I was contesting in a constituency where the indigenous people make up the majority with a small minority of non-indigenous people. Now, the indigenous people are divided exactly into two, 50-50, and it is the minority which decided who should win, and I lost because the minority didn't quite like me. Now look at the United States. One always wonders, why is it that the United States is so slavish in following instruction coming from Tel Aviv? I mean, Tel Aviv is a small country. And the number of Jews in America is only about 10 million. And yet, even if Tel Aviv commits a crime, like driving a tractor over an American girl, United States still supports Tel Aviv, does not support the American girl. The reason is that there are 10 million Jewish people in the United States, but the United States people are divided into two. The Gentiles are divided into two, Republican and Democrats. They almost get the same number of votes. And it is this small group of Jews working together with control over the media, control over the finances, control over Hollywood. They are the people who actually throw their votes for the candidate who appears to be supporting Israel most. So the people who are contesting in America are afraid of this small group of people. And Cynthia will tell you that you have to make a pledge to to support Israel or you will lose, and you lost. There are other people who refused, who wrote a book. I forgot what his name was, but this man, Paul Finn, he wrote a book to expose the lobby, the Israeli lobby, the IPAC, and he lost. After winning for four times, but the fifth time for writing that book, he lost. Why? It's because he wrote something against the Jews and his lobby. So this small group of people became powerful because the bigger group are actually divided between Republicans and the Democrats. And because of that, candidates become frightened of the Jewish lobby. And they invariably pledge to support Israel or else they would lose. Now, I think we can play the same role as the small Jewish lobby. What we need to do is to convince enough Americans and European voters, not the whole lot of them, not even the majority of them, just enough European and American voters about the lies that they have been made to believe, the lies about 9/11. And it's not so difficult to convince people. I'm quite sure that many who came, who attended this session, came with doubts. But after hearing, I think most of the doubts have disappeared. Because now they know that people are talking not about suspicions or theories or anything, but about facts. And because of that, people are convinced. I'm quite sure that we can convince enough Americans, especially young Americans, enough Europeans, so that they can voice their dislike for people who insist that there should be no commission of inquiry on 9/11. Or, better still, that they should say that they do not believe in what the official report was saying. Now, if we can get them to come across and force the candidates in elections that they should not believe in what happened on 9/11, as reported by the official media, then I think we would have made tremendous progress. And today, although we cannot control the media, I mean, they are very unfriendly, as Professor Chosudovsky said just now, they are very unfriendly, but some are friendly, I must admit. We have this alternative media, and the alternative media reaches more people than the print media or even the TV. You mentioned just now about this Gangnam dance by a person from Korea whose name is PSY. I don't know how do you pronounce that? Psy. He, in one day, he managed to get about 1 million hits, I think, because of his dance. So the alternative media is a very powerful media. And we have enough people who can talk convincingly, who can write convincingly about what happened, what really happened on 9/11. There will be sufficient number of people who initially would question themselves whether what they believed before was true or not, and who might eventually be convinced. Now, these people are voters in Europe and in America. And if we can get sufficient number of them to overturn the votes by giving their votes to the people, the candidates who do not pledge to support Israel, or better still, who say they are not convinced as to the report made by the government, and that there should be a new inquiry by neutral people, I think that would be another approach. I'm not saying that the commission shouldn't go on. It should go on. it might even contribute towards convincing enough people so that the candidates in elections in Europe and in America will know the power of this small group of people, and if they don't question the veracity of the reports, then they are going to lose. This is the only language that politicians understand. I'm a politician and I understand. And these are the politicians who eventually will end up heading governments. And if we can elect governments who question the 9/11 story, then I think we have made tremendous progress. I thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else from the floor? Yes, please.
First of all, I would like to mention it's a great honor and pleasure to be to see Dr. Mahathir in person today. I am Professor Suleiman from Pakistan, and I would like to carry forward from what Professor Chusadovsky mentioned. The setting up another commission for the truth finding in terms of 9/11 calls for, I think, I would suggest, another action. If we fast forward 9/11 into the aftermath of 9/11, and I think this is an action which also need to be included within what this commission should be doing. We fast forward, and what are the after, or what's the aftermath? What happened after that? First of all, for example, and this commission should be having an investigation in 360 degrees rather than 180 degrees, not what happened and why happened, and that's all. The immediate effect after that, the scope of inquiry of such a commission should see, first of all, what was the first effect? U.S. declaration of war on terror. First of all, the first effect, and immediately after that, we see marking certain countries for attack. Iraq, Afghanistan, these are the casualties that we see. I come from a country which is a silent casualty, I would say. In the last 11 years, I have seen my country, Pakistan, going from where to where. And we stand nowhere among the casualties. Libya, we can see. Egypt, we can see. Syria, we can see. Egypt, Afghanistan, we can see. Egypt, we can, Iraq, we can see. But we have, in the name of de-Talibanization, what we have suffered is basically what comes as the effect of what happened on 9/11. So I think America has achieved, or the U.S. has achieved what it had to achieve. It has already been done. The countries it wanted to destroy are already destroyed. The first Islamic nuclear power, Pakistan, the nuclear program rolled back. The next Iran, or whatever it is, it's there. So the point that any contribution which the next commission would be able to make, that is yet to see, of course, for the generations to come, for the centuries to come, there must be a commission so that, as Dr. Mahathir has pointed out, that this is the language that the politicians understand. And for their understanding, these commissions would be useful. But it would be important to include, and this commission would not serve any purpose if such an action is not included within the jurisdiction or within the prospects within which this commission should be acting, if the aftermath or the after effects as a direct result of 9/11 are not recorded. It's very much there. The power of the alternative media, of course, we all know. But at the same time, as already mentioned, that the streamlined media also needs to be targeted. Okay, that will all be done. But that would be incomplete if the commission is unable to include what American statements, direct statements, have been as a result of war on terror. Okay. Thank you very much.
Yes?
Try to keep it short because we have got to wrap up in a short while. Yes.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Chia. I'm from Sokagakai, Malaysia. So thank you very much for the enlightening sessions. So for me, just like what Tun Mahathir has said, is really an eye-opening and also clearing doubts session for me. So I'm thinking that this kind of education and awareness campaign is very important. And if we can start from the young one, it will be a very good tool to prevent that the same kind of misery is going to happen in the future. So I would like to suggest from my very limited knowledge that we can run an awareness campaign in the campus targeting at the students, like organizing forum or exhibitions, videos and things like that. So to expose the truth to the young ones. So hopefully that we can nurture a generation of justice and seeking truth. Thank you.
Thank you.
May I respond to the gentleman from Pakistan? May I respond to the gentleman from Pakistan? I would just like to say that you're absolutely right. And Pakistan has been one of the most mistreated of the so-called U.S. allies. I'll be in Pakistan next week to plead for the release of Dr. Afia Siddiqui, who is one of the most, for our Iraq war tribunal with Moazzam Begg, when he heard the cries and the screams of a woman prisoner who was imprisoned near his cell or cage, he suspected that it was Dr. Afia Siddiqui. The crimes that have been committed against peoples and whole countries in the name of this war on terror, the crimes that have been committed by people who purport to represent me and spend my tax dollars is unspeakable and it's unacceptable. And I am so appreciative of the words of Dr. Mahathir because it is now time, I believe, that people in the United States, I have worked for a very long time to cross that Republican divide, black, white, people of color, all of these divisions that we're supposed to have in the United States that divide us. And something has happened, and I believe that with the proper spark, we can achieve a critical mass of people who are willing to say, I'm not going to vote for war anymore. I'm going to vote for a candidate who will not vote for war. I will vote for a candidate who will tell me the truth about what happened on September 11th. I think we've reached that point with just a little push, with just a little opportunity for more information to see that there's a community out there, a larger community out there to which they can attach themselves, I believe we will be able to see some changes. But particularly now in the U.S. Congress, I don't know if my words sank into you, but 535 members of Congress voted to support Operation Pillar of Cloud just 2 or 3 days ago. Unanimous in the House, unanimous in the Senate. And there is no greater divide than between the people who are outraged at this way that their tax dollars are being spent and the elected representatives, those with positional authority, who supposedly represent the interests of these people. Ron Paul was able to garner that angry white man voter, and Ron Paul will be out of the Congress when the next Congress is sworn in. Dennis Kucinich was able to garner the progressive voter, and he'll be out of the Congress when the next Congress is sworn in. That's how you get 535 unanimous vote for something as abhorrent as what is happening now in Gaza. That's how it happens. All we need is one success story to turn it around. That's all we need, is one success story to provide a little hope for people. So anyway, I'm sure that if we proceed in any kind of way, it'll be more than anything we've had thus far. And that will be, I believe, the hope that we need to re-energize a latent movement that's out there just waiting for somebody to say, okay, here's the way, here's a hand. So thank you, and thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. And one last speaker, but keep it short because we have, after that, okay, two last speakers.
I'm lost for words, actually. You know, there's one person in our lives who's very important, who may still be here or passed away, and that person is our first educator, mentor, and core in the family. That's our mother. I'm glad somebody suggested that we should create awareness in the universities and tell children, and we always say they are the future, and yet this is the future we're living them with. But I'm glad that, I'm so happy that Her Excellency Tun Hasma has actually started. She's going to start two charters on criminalized war in two schools, and on Thursday we'll be listening to four speakers to talk about war-affected children. Please come. Please come and see. Yes, we've heard today about the lies, but just think of the future of our children. Do come on Thursday and listen with your heart. Think with your heart. Listen with your heart and work with your head. Thank you.
Yes.
Hi, testing. I've got a question for everyone here. Yeah, I'm actually a student from Brookfields, and I want to know, it's all fine and dandy for Ms. McKinney that, look, a bill has passed in Congress and therefore we're going to follow it, but here you are, and we've been here since 9 o'clock and you've been speaking about how 9/11 and the reason why we're here in the first place to learn about the fallacies and the inconsistencies, the bill, those things, they weren't passed in Congress. These were things beyond what we could see, beyond what we want our government to achieve. These are things which are hidden in secret, right? Secret, the CIA. How are we supposed to exactly go up and say, look, we want transparency, we want transparency in the CIA, we want transparency in the American intelligence? That's one thing. On another note, we're looking at the highest, one of the biggest powers, if not the largest, biggest nation right now, USA, right? And we want to persecute the USA for crimes as such. However, how are we supposed to do that when it is right now the leading biggest power? What are we going to do? Are we going to bring it to the ICC? Fine, it's fine to set up a commission, but what if the commission fails? Where are we going to persecute? Who are we going to persecute? And under whose judgment? And if such fails, the question is, what then?
Anyone wants to answer the question here? Yes, Nirufa?
Thank you.
You see, when you initiate public action or political action, or a struggle or a movement, you do it because it is absolutely essential and because other fora or forums, legal and otherwise, or the legislatures have failed. So the issue is not, well, how do you translate it into immediate effective action? What we are faced, what we've been facing with, what we have been faced with, and what has been attempted to be countered in Kuala Lumpur by Perdana and the KL Tribunal, is to get the voice of humanity heard in a situation where there has been darkness and lack of information and lack of dissemination of what is going on in the world. So the action that you take may not result in, let us say, an immediate prosecution, but the education and the struggle process, getting information out on essential issues on which there is absolutely a cloak of secrecy, is extremely important, particularly in a situation where you've got fascist business models who do not allow the citizens to get public information forward. I don't know whether I have made my point. So the question is not what happens next and what happens next. It's important. It is very important to get the truth out. As Mahatma Gandhi always said, he raised the struggle for truth into a political struggle and a strategy also. Because he felt, and he believed, and he made us all believe, that resistance against tyranny lies in the search for truth and in the dissemination of truth. And the rest was history. The first major mass anti-colonial struggle of the world.
Thank you very much. I'm going to close the proceedings. I do not propose to sum up the many useful recommendations that have been made. What we will do is we will, in fact, provide a summary in writing and then circulate them to the participants for final feedback. But what is very clear is that there must be an ongoing movement for the search for truth through some structured mechanism which will engage society as a whole and look at all possible facets, including alternative media. Because at the end of the day, people armed with truth are the motive force in the making of world history. And that is very clear. And finally, sometimes it looks bleak, but without the cold and bitterness of winter, we will never experience the warmth and splendor of spring. With that, I thank you very much.
Thank you to our esteemed panel of...
Sorry,
oh, yes. You're not finished. Okay.
Yes, proceed. Should I close it, or are you going to say something?
You're going to close? Please, go ahead.
Yes, I just wanted to, thank the panel who have made this incredible contribution, as well as the participants who have been so actively engaged in this whole process. Perhaps we all deserve a clap. Thank you.
Thank you once again to our esteemed panel, our moderator, and our panel of thought leaders and action leaders, and we certainly look forward to the beginning of the implementation of the proposals and suggestions. And once again, thank you. And for the closing, I would like to invite the chairman of PGPF, and that is Yang Berbahagia Tan Sri Norian Mai, for his closing remarks. Thank you.
Assalamualaikum Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Yang amat berbahagia Tun Dr. Mahathir Mohamad, the advisor of PGPF, Your Excellencies, speakers, moderators, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, on behalf of PGPF, I would like to take this opportunity to thank the distinguished chairmen of all the sessions and all the expert speakers and all the participants who contributed to the success of our conference today. The speakers' analysis, explanation, observation, and comment on 9/11 from various perspectives and dimensions were factual, scientific, and convincing in order to challenge the official account on 9/11 and in support of conspiracy theory. I'm sure, as a thinking person, the critical information on 9/11 would be the basis for yourself to arrive at the right conclusion and to see it in the proper perspective. As far as PGPF is concerned, the truth must be exposed. Ladies and gentlemen, it has been more than a decade since the fateful day when the 11th September, or now better known as 9/11 tragedy, occurred. In most tragedies, whether it is personal or otherwise, time is always the best healer. We move on, pick up the pieces, and bury the pain of the past. But there are also tragedies that keep nagging, not allowing us to find a closure. And 9/11 is such a tragedy. Your presence and interest in our conference today bears the testimony to this. If the immediate impact of 9/11 incident left us flabbergasted and shocked, the unfurling event led to many of us wondering and questioning the truthfulness of the official narrative. We question as how can a superpower such as the United States fail to intervene the hijacked planes. We also wonder how did the Twin Towers collapse like that when only an expert demolition team could have affected such precision. We also find it difficult to believe that Osama bin Laden could have masterminded such a fantastic feat from thousands of miles in a primitive setting and yet escape the American sophistication. Much of this and more were addressed candidly by our speakers, who are experts and witnesses to the whole 9/11 episode that became the single most influential event that charted the contemporary history of mankind. Since the fateful day, we have seen how the Bush administration has swung into action and unilaterally declared his war on terror. His pronouncement, as mentioned by one of our distinguished speakers, that's it, you are either with us or against us, reverberated through modern civilization for us to then witness one of the most barbaric acts of aggression in the present time. First was attack on Afghanistan, and then followed by an invasion of Iraq. Since then, the world has not been any safer, and if not, we live in fear of when the next act of aggression is going to be committed. All this can be traced back to 9/11 that resulted in the declaration of the war on terror. If we had listened carefully to all our speakers, it is obvious that 9/11 is indeed a conspiracy, and in most cases, when a tragedy is willfully committed, we then raise chi bono, or the question who benefits. As pointed out, the war on terror saw Washington strongly supported by Britain and endorsed by clueless members of the coalition of the willing invading Afghanistan and Iraq. In the invasion of Iraq especially, the President of the United States and the Prime Minister of Britain lied and misinformed the institution, the citizen, of the existence of weapon of mass destruction. They argued if they were not contained, their nation and population were prime targets. Such is the fear of the citizen of this nation following 9/11. And despite some of them doubting the veracity of such pronouncement, the two leaders were by and large supported to commit the war crime on Iraq. That resulted Iraq from a modern, sophisticated, and wealthy nation, befitting its legacy as the cradle of human civilization, is reduced to rubble, its population devastated, and still lost in a chaotic day-to-day existence. The leaders of war on terror had undermined sovereignty and self-determination in many nations, all justified by the need to export democracy into nations led by those deemed to be supporters of terrorism. Regime change is a catchphrase that is associated with the need to export democracy, and it is spreading at the whim and fancy of these leaders. In this respect, the U.S. government and allies have manipulated and exploited the fear syndrome among their citizens with the cooperation of media, and the media, electronic, or the normal newspapers. Our speakers have provided us with the insight and on how the 9/11 conspiracy was hatched and how the tragedy was then used to justify the New World Order. Surely the conspirators of 9/11 must be exposed and, if possible, to be brought to justice. Their crimes are definitely crimes against humanity, and these crimes are still continuing, perpetuated and promoted. 9/11 has brought the world to their knees. In this regard, the recommendation of the conference, as we just have heard from the for the International Commission of Inquiry, although it is not finalized, as an investigative body, would be the way forward. For as long as the 9/11 truths remain veiled and concealed, it will be used as a pretext to wage war on terrorism. We at the PGPF, under the guidance of Tun Mahathir Mohamad as our advisor, will examine the recommendation from the distinguished speakers with a view to implement on the priority basis. With that, we truly appreciate your presence here and hope that you find yourself time here stimulating and thought-provoking. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much to Tan Sri Norian Mai, the chairman of PGPF, for your closing remarks. I'd like to request that Tan Sri remain on stage. We're going to have a group photo session before we let you go. I would like to invite Yang Amat Bahagia Tun Dr. Mahathir Mohamad, joined by the chairman of all the previous sessions from the morning till late afternoon, to come up on stage for a photo session. I'd like to announce a press conference right after this in the Anglet Room, and Tun Dr. Mahathir will be there. There'll be a press conference right after this in the Anglet Room. And today's event video can be viewed online at www.perdanaforpeace.org. And don't forget tomorrow, the commission hearing on Palestine. On Thursday, the International Conference on War-Affected Children. And of course, be there, be here tomorrow for the emergency event, the special event, Malaysians Condemn the Unjust War in Gaza. And Dr. Mahathir will be addressing us tomorrow. And it will also see the launch of the Gaza Emergency Fund, the handover of check to the medical aid for Palestine, and pledges of support from NGOs and corporations. So do your bit. Please, we call upon all Malaysians to stand up and be counted in this support initiative. Tomorrow morning from 8 o'clock, we see all of you here. Don't forget. And in closing, I would like to quote from the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 42. And mix not truth with falsehood, nor conceal the truth while you know the truth. Have a very good evening, and we'll see you next few days.